Welcome to Marquee Backstage All Access. I'm your host, Julie Milam. This week, we're taking you behind the scenes to discover the life and music of Rick Monroe. With an energetic country resonance, Monroe is no stranger to the stage. He's performed in every state in the U.S. except for Oregon and has an international following. To show you why he's a true music sensation, here's Rick Monroe singing Nothing to Do with You from his Smoke Out the Window album.
So much this man can take. Push to the edge, hell, I might as well jump. Sick and tired of being treated like dirt, eating dust just trying to catch up. Times I wish I had nothing to do. Nothing to do with you but holding the covers, girl, me and you. Knock some boots, leave the mail in the box, let a dog in the yard, baby, let's hide all cars in the garage, so no one knows that we're at home. Yeah, there's a bottle of wine that's calling our name, got that slow jam just waiting to be played. I'm so glad I've got nothing to know. Nothing to do with you but pulling the covers, girl, me and you. Barefoot, but we're knocking boots. Take you around the world, I'll leave in a row. I want nothing to do with you, babe.
Rick was born in Florida and grew up in a variety of places, California, Connecticut, Kansas, North Carolina, even England. And his infectious personality and deep love of music continues to draw him to the stage. Join me and Rick as he takes us down memory lane to explain how his mom was one of his biggest influences and how his career first began. After that, get ready for Rick's performance of the raw and gritty track, Good As Gone.
Let's see. I guess I first fell in love with music when my mom used to listen, like, I think CCR was one of her favorite bands. And she would, like, tap the brakes to the groove. And so I would always kind of feel that. And I think that's where it started. And I actually started off wanting to be a drummer when I was younger. So that's kind of from that. And then so my mom was way into singer-songwriters like Jim Croce and John Denver and all that kind of stuff. But then my brother turned me on to Hank Williams Jr., Garth Brooks, and then Judas Priest and AC/DC. So I ended up with a pretty eclectic, you know, love of music. That was very cool. So I remember her breaking to songs. And she said she's always used to do that, even when I was in, you know, in the womb. So I guess it just kind of rhythm became, you know, part of what I do. So.
It's a great way to feel the music, though.
Yeah, yeah. And that's all, I mean, that's one of the things I think I've been really fortunate about, you know, even though I'm a singer, as a writer and everything, I'm pretty rhythmic and thinking because I started off as a drummer. And I believe that that kind of, it's really helpful to create a sound to be rhythmic. And so when I think of things rhythmically, when I'm recording or I'm writing, I don't just think melodies. I think, you know, I'm very much, you know, both those. I think I'm stronger on melodies than I actually am on words. That's why I love co-writing with people, because sometimes I'm kind of like, I know what I want to say, but I don't know. And you get the right co-writer and, you know, they'll go check it out. But I get the rhythmic feel. I just remember when I started off, I remember getting a drum set when I was like 8 or 9 years old and driving my poor parents crazy, you know, and they actually moved me to a room on the other side of the house. And I just kept doing that. And then one day I remember seeing some video, and I believe it or not, it was like a Van Halen video. And I saw David Lee Roth is like on stage in front of, you know, 50,000 people going, I got me a brand new Oakland scarf. And I was like, that's a much cooler gig than sitting behind the drums. And I'm like, huh. Plus, I don't have to carry all the gear. And I think I'm going to change gigs. I remember my dad looked at me and he's like, you can't carry a tune. Why would you ever want to become a singer? So I ended up going out and trying to learn how to play guitar and started writing. I just started writing before I did anything else.
Boy, did you show him.
Yeah, he's actually a big fan now.
I cannot imagine why.
Yeah.
So when you were writing songs and playing guitar, what style of music felt most natural to you?
It's definitely singer-songwriter is the base of everything. I think that's the basic. But it's also, when I first went to Nashville, one of the first things I remember saying to a producer is like, I want like the thump, the heartbeat of rock with the storytelling of country. And I got to tell you, I had more people be like, man, we don't do that around here. I'm like, what? And they're like, no, man, we don't, that's not what we do. And I'm like, no, it was, because I moved to Nashville about almost 13 years ago now. And at that time, you know, they were the Jason Aldean thing hadn't quite happened. And I was trying to explain that to them. And they're just like, man, I don't know, that doesn't happen. And then, you know, that kind of started happening. And you know, now it's hip hop is the big thing. So I don't know. I mean, one thing I do love about music now is it's not as genre specific as it used to be. And I definitely think that we fall into that category of just music. I mean, we definitely have a country edge and a flavor, but we're not limited to that. You know, if we want to cover Ace of Spades by Motorhead, we can. We do. If we want to do, you know, a hip hop song, we do. If we want to do a pop song, we do. Well, we ended up throwing One Direction in the middle of a Johnny Cash tune just to mess with people. So. Yeah.
And they loved every minute of it.
Freaks people out. And as long as you can do it well, you can get away with anything.
And I think that really does grow your fan base.
Yeah.
Because they see your versatility.
Well, and I like to work with a bunch of different artists and do things. You know, we actually covered a Hailstorm song. And it was kind of a joke because I was making fun of the fact that Glee covered it. And they were like, well, if you can do it better. So I think we did a pretty cool version of it. So we cut Here's to Us by them. So.
And you did a great job.
Thank you.
So is this the path you thought your career would take?
No, I thought I'd be rich and famous by now. I don't know what's going on.
Doesn't that happen for everybody?
I've never really thought about where I would end up or what I would be. It more that I'm just really grateful that I'm still doing it, that I'm still playing music. I started playing music when I was a little kid, and that's what I do for a living. It's not like I have a job and then go play music on the weekend. It's not like I'm a part-time. I mean, this is literally my job, and that's pretty amazing. And I had a friend that, you know, he manages Guns N' Roses. Well, Slash from Guns N' Roses, basically Guns N' Roses at this point. And I was bitching about, man, I'm just not getting anywhere. And he finally goes, you realize you're at the top 5% of your field? He goes, you really are. He goes, you make a living playing music. That's, you don't do anything else. Because literally 95% of the people in your industry do not. And goes incrementally, of course, as you go up, you know, the 4% make a whole lot more than the 3% that do. You know. So he's like, so stop your bitching and be grateful. So
enjoy every moment. You know what? You are one of the few people who are earning a living doing what you absolutely love.
Right.
And that is so rare. It is truly a gift, but it shows that you're surrounded by the right people.
Well, actually, I think it's just God, because I mean, it's divine intervention, because all the things that could have happened to trip me up and send me in the wrong direction, I've always kind of been shuffled off into the right place. So, I mean, I'm still here for some reason. I'm still making music. So obviously there must be some, you know, bigger plan. So I just try to get out of my own way. I think that's the biggest problem, is getting in your own way. And I think that's where most people make mistakes, because everybody sits around and goes, well, why haven't I achieved certain things? But look at your habits. Look at the things you don't do. Look at the things you miss. Look at the things you don't focus on. Or look at the things you focus on. So, you know, you really have to have a very pure, realistic look at yourself and who you are as a person, not just what your ideology of who you are. And sometimes having bad people around you, not bad in the sense of they're bad, but people that give you a false sense of reality, can create some bad things. So really weed out people that are just yes, yes, yes all the time, and, you know, take the hit every once in a while and look at yourself.
Well, it definitely teaches you where you need to be.
Yeah.
And shows you, Mr. Monroe, this is your purpose.
Well, you also got to be pretty humble about it. Like, I love the fact when we go into venues and people are amazed that we're not demanding everything. Look, man, we don't cure cancer. We don't. We play music. I mean, music is very important in the world, but it is not a necessity. You know, you can't eat it. You can't, you know, live under it. You can't be warmed by it. You can't. It's important, but it's not the most important thing. So when I see artists imposing their will as we're so important, it's like, I just want to go trip them and, you know, knock them back down to reality. You know, it's just music, you know. I mean, it's great, but, like, you know, I always say to people, you know, we're not curing cancer. And the person who does that could be the biggest a-hole in the world, and I'd be fine with it, because that needs to happen.
That's exactly right. You all have your purpose,
yeah,
but yours is a gift.
Yeah, and you have to share your gift with people and then be humble about it. I mean, there's no reason not to be. I mean, everybody, you know, everybody is important in the machine of what's going on. So to treat anybody less than anything else it just blows my mind. I just don't understand that. I was just raised not to be that kind of person.
Well, you care genuinely about people.
Yeah.
And you really want to elevate everyone's life that you come into contact with.
Yeah.
And that is the purpose.
It's what you hope. It's what you try to do.
It's what we're here to do.
Yeah.
We'll do it together.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I get restless when I stay in one place too long. Guess it's best if I get moving on. Hey!
For personal photos of Rick and videos from our shoot, check out our YouTube channel at Marquee Backstage. Next, we sit down with guitar player extraordinaire, Bobby Perkins. Bobby opens up about his friendship with Rick and what it's like to live life on the road with this monster of an artist. After that, get ready for a powerful performance of Ease On Down from Rick's latest release, Gypsy Soul. Bobby, in the 3 years since you left New York, you've spent the last year and a half on the road with Rick Monroe. What is that like? And what was your first impression of Rick?
Well, let's go to my first impression, because when I moved to Nashville about 3 years ago, I've been with Rick now about a year and a half, but when I first moved there, I did not have a road gig, so this is my first road gig with him. And I was only filling the spot for a month because his original guitar player was on like an indefinite hiatus, and the bass player at the time was the band leader. He was my friend, and he figured, hey, I could do the job, so he introduced me to Rick. Rick actually was a super nice guy, had a big smile, and just he was excited to have me on to fill the spot. And I thought that was really cool, you know, to have for not to have this look of, you know, I have high expectations, you better get them done or else. So that was really, that was relaxed because of that. It can be pretty intimidating. So of course, I went on the road, did the job for the month, and the other guitar player didn't come back. And so I've stayed with him ever since. And it's been great. We've been traveling the country. I've seen states and places that I've never seen before, never been to, and playing music. So, you know, that's a win-win for me.
It's everything you ever wanted.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. For a first road gig, how could you beat that? So, and he's just a really easy guy to work with. He's very accommodating, even for all the things that go alongside with playing your guitar, like whether it's hotel stays, food, people you meet, gear deals, you know, music gear deals. He's a big part of that. And there's, you know, there's really no bind to that as well. So.
So you'd say you're learning a lot with Rick.
Oh, absolutely. In a good way too. You know, you're not picking up on bad habits. You're learning the right things to do. And if we all make mistakes, we all do them together and we try to build from them. Nobody points any fingers or holds anybody accountable or tries to put the blame on somebody else. We're all a team. So
I would say you probably also learn a lot more about Rick Monroe than you did a year and a half ago.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Even the first month when I was just doing the job, I still tried to keep an open mind. But once I was locked in, we opened up a little bit more. We already were, but opened up more so and became a lot closer and experienced life together, even outside of being on the road, back home together. And it's been a really good time. He's been a really good friend, or became a really good friend because of that.
So what are some of your fondest memories of you guys out on the road together?
That's a good question. Some of our fondest memories on the road, I'd say, was all the pit stops along the way to our destination. Such as when we go out to Sturgis Bike Week in South Dakota, we'll stop at the Badlands. And I don't know if you've never seen the Badlands, it's a pretty amazing sight. So get to walk right out there on the cliffs. You know, it's a little scary, but you know, when you walk out there and see it, it's pretty amazing. So it's the little things like that. Like we went to Mount Rushmore afterwards. After we were going to Sturgis, where else have I gone? Like California. And going through, you know, the Grand Canyon and Arizona and Las Vegas. So just it's the little things like that that I enjoy in the being on the road with Rick.
Yeah, it's not all work all the time.
No.
You get to be normal human beings, experience the world together, and share those experiences too.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. And that's a wonderful thing about social media, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, you name it. You get to share it with everybody, and they live vicariously through you. They all want to be there. And they tell you that too, and that's when you realize that what you're doing is important to somebody, or it really means something, or somebody else is watching.
So what about your family back home? What do they think of how your career has grown since you've been working with Rick?
They actually love it. They knew that this is what I wanted to do, that I finally set out to do it. They're proud, and I appreciate their support. And honestly, you know, as a child to my teenage years to my young adult years, still back home in New York, they're also supportive and just did whatever they could to make sure that, you know, I was happy with what I was doing. And they've never once questioned me what I was doing and said, you know, I don't think that career's for you, or that's not a good career to have. You need to do something that's a little more stable. They've never once done that. They're all artists themselves. They all love music. So a lot of them are musicians as well. So they get it.
So I think the Rick Monroe fan club in New York is a little bit bigger now that you're on the team.
Oh, big time, yeah. Big time.
So what have you not experienced with Rick yet that you would love to do?
Well, like headline arenas, I guess. You know, that's what everybody wants in the end, right? That's kind of the end vision. We're hoping to get to that point, even if we're just a supporting artist for somebody really big, playing big arenas. And, you know, everybody wants to have people, the whole crowd, like in the thousands, singing your song, right? That's what everybody would love to hear and see. So that's, I think, something that we would all like to experience together. I would love to be there for him when that does happen, or be there with him when that's happening.
Well, it'll happen, and it will absolutely complete the dream.
Oh, absolutely.
Anything that you have learned that you didn't expect from this experience so far?
I've met some people that I did not expect to meet and whatnot, and like how to use them as like a person. You're all in the same industry together, and how you can network with them and use them as a useful tool, you know, and just establish a relationship beyond just, oh, we're using each other somehow. Like, it's actually like, embrace this friendship, and you might not look for any benefits out of it, but something will transpire in 10, 15 years.
Well, it's great to know that you have other people that you can lean on that really understand what your day-to-day looks like.
Right, right. Because some of the gear deals that we have with some of these companies, you meet some of these people and you just figure, okay, I'm just going to see them one time and just kind of walk right past them. Then you realize how much you might need them down the road. So it's always good to spend a little extra time with those people and really, make those relationships mean something. You know.
Yeah, when they genuinely want to see you do well and they want to be there to help you.
Right. Oh, yeah. Being genuine is a big part of this industry, for sure. Yeah, people see right through it if you're not.
That's right. Well, we're all here to help you. We're excited to see where you go.
Thank you.
Arena Bound.
Said 100 ways you can live to love another day, but ain't nothing wrong with the one we're in right now. Kick back on the front porch swing, letting the world just do its thing. Warm breeze is kissing your face, sun is setting now. Sitting over there, baby, move a little closer. Rather have you than this world on my shoulders any day. There ain't nothing any better. You and me together when you slow down, honey, just like that. Loving every moment like it's gonna be the last. And I take our time here and now, and we'll ease on. Getting late, let's go inside and cap the day. Got a bottle of wine by that bedside, candles already lit. The way you kiss me crazy, baby, slow and steady. Got me feeling alright already. Take a deep breath, and my hair starts moving softly on your skin. I love it when you move in a little bit closer. Only you can take this world off my shoulders when you say there ain't nothing any better. You and me together when you slow down, honey, just like that. Loving every moment like it's gonna be the last. And take our time here and now, and we'll ease on. Sit around and wonder where we'll be tomorrow. Every day you spend, that's a day about from another one. I know, you know, I know we got to slow down, honey.
it just like that. Loving every moment like it's the last. Gonna take our time here and now, and we'll ease on, slow down, honey, just like that. Loving every moment like it's gonna be the last. And take our time here and now, and we'll ease on.
We'd like to thank Thundersound Studios for letting us film our show from their fully equipped analog and digital recording studio complex in Franklin, Kentucky. For more information about Thundersound, please visit thundersound.com. Now let's dive back in to see what's next for Rick Monroe and the massive support he has behind his career. We'll follow that up with Rick's sultry single, which has garnered great chart success.
Big things happening, Rick Monroe.
I hope so.
Man, you've come so far.
Well, we try. Well, we travel a lot. We do a lot of miles, so hopefully we'll get somewhere.
How many miles so far?
See, we have a vehicle that we got in 2017, and we've already done 230,000 miles on that. That's not our fly dates or anything. That's just that one vehicle.
Right. And that's about when we met you.
Yeah.
So a lot has happened.
And yeah, about the last 2.5 years. So.
Huge shows.
Yeah.
Huge
we're
career.
There. Yeah.
What's your favorite part so far?
I think the coolest thing is, I kind of went a couple of years ago. I was sponsored by Jaeger, and I was kind of in a bubble because I was there. I basically was like the face of Jaeger for country. So for about 8 years, I was doing major tours, but I was just kind of like the MC and the acoustic opener. So it was never about. I was literally an afterthought, and it was great because I mean I made good money, and Jaeger was a great company.
Great intro.
But I wasn't really. Everybody would say, "Oh, the Jaeger guy, Rick." Even the main artists were like, oh, you're a Jaeger guy. I'm like, no, I'm actually an artist. I don't know if you caught my set earlier, you know. And they'd be like, oh. By the end of the tour, like, oh, wow, you're pretty good. So about 3-4 years ago, that all ended. And so we kind of had to start from scratch, which was weird going from being on a tour bus, my own tour bus, you know, and having everything taken care of and playing, you know, in front of huge crowds to starting back from scratch, because we really did have to start from scratch. There's a big fallacy in this industry that if you get on radio or you get certain things that you're making it. But you really, it's a slug. You have to get in there and get into the whole dirt and grind of it. And that's what we had to do. And so we basically started over about 4 years ago. And now it's just finally starting to pay off.
You have a lot of support, not just fan support. Yeah. But you have a lot of businesses and industries that support
I don't know what you're talking about.
What are some of the ways that these endorsements have really helped spark your career?
Well, let's see. It gives you some validity. Having a company, especially like Monster. I mean, Monster's a major company. We've been so blessed to be involved with them and their music program. And they tend to look at things. I mean, really, if you look at their country roster, I mean, it's Cole Swindell, Dustin Lynch, and I think myself, and then a couple other artists, but that's not big.
Never heard of any of you.
Yeah. So, and I'm definitely the smallest guy on, I'm the lowest guy on that totem pole.
No.
But they still treat me as if I was as important to them as anybody, and I love that company. And they give us the ability, like, we're about to rewrap the vehicle with a new, really cool thing, all new branding. Everything, and they're a big part of that. So we couldn't do it without them. We have companies like Roper Boots. Yes. So I wouldn't be able to walk around if it weren't for them.
Your feet would freeze.
My feet would freeze. They wouldn't look as cool. These boots are awesome.
They are awesome.
Can't see those. And it's just like, you know, string companies, guitar companies. I have like Framus is my guitar company. GHS is a string company. I mean, I'm like a NASCAR driver. I should just have little
logos everywhere.
But without these companies, it's not just the endorsement for the sake of getting free gear. It's the fact that we're on the road, and if something breaks down or I have an issue, I can call somebody and say, hey, you know, this doesn't do anything. Or we can also do R&D for them and say, you need to make this stronger, you need to do that. And they listen to us.
It's a great partnership.
And it's great because, I mean, you know, I love the guitars I play. I love all the gear that I have. I use stuff that I only like. It's not like I'm just, you know, whoring myself out for whatever. Hey, cool, give me some money. So, I mean, I did back when I first started try to get a bunch of stuff. But, and plus with sponsorships, I think it falls on our shoulders to be a good ambassador for them. Absolutely. A lot of people are always like, well, give me, give me, give me. I'm like, well, the point is what can I give that company to makes it worth them giving me something? And we can have a good simpatico relationship. So that's kind of how I look at it.
Well, it's how partnerships work.
Yeah.
It's give and take.
Right.
We're going to go into this partnership because there's something that's going to benefit you.
Everybody.
And something that's going to benefit
us. Yeah, it's
got to
be mutually beneficial. And like I said, I know a lot of guys were like, well, how do you... And everybody's always asking me, how did you get this? How did you get that? And they want me to, you know, get them, hook them up with everybody. I'm like, man, I literally got on the phone and grinded and grinded and grinded until I got something. And so...
And look where you are now.
You know, but it's just, and it's still, I mean, you know, and you have to be able to take no, and then you have to give them a reason to want to work with you. Right. So that's, you have to do your work first.
You have to prove yourself.
Yeah.
And you've done a great job
doing that. Well,
thank you.
We're trying. I mean, unfortunately, because I'm right in the front lines, I don't see what victories we've made. I just kind of keep seeing the next battle ahead.
But your environment's different. I would say that your support system is probably much larger than you anticipated when you started.
Definitely, and it's getting more so with as we kind of, you know, the group kind of gets more solidified with the guys that I'm out on the road with. And there are people, I mean, there are a lot of people that are extremely helpful. I mean, that's a huge thing. I mean, you can't, I mean, you, even though we're pretty much an army of one at this point, because we don't do management, we don't have any of that, you know, support staff, but we have really good people that when I need to lean on them and call on them for things, you know, they're there. So that's important.
It absolutely gives you the strength to keep going.
Yeah.
And to keep going
I'm
and
just too
growing.
Stupid to stop. That's all. It's not even, there's no other
We're
reason.
Not going to let you stop. You're on to some great things. Talk about some of the new music that you have because it's incredible.
I just was in the studio yesterday and it was crazy because we just wrote a song. And it was funny. I wrote the song with a buddy, Dave Norris, and he's like, man, we need to do like this trop rock thing. I'm like, I'm not big on trop rock. But then he showed me this idea. And then I was like, man, that kind of has a Blink 182 feel to it. And he's like, what? I'm like, yeah, no, if we did it like this. So now we end up having this new song called Fall in Love Tonight. It probably won't be out till summer, but it is a summer smash. It's like Blink 182 meets Kenny Chesney meets Foo Fighters meets Bob Marley. Weirdest thing I've ever done. And he kind of had to force me, like, you know, kicking and screaming to cut it.
You weren't interested at
like,
all.
Nah. I'm like, dude, that's not me. But when we finally did it, it was cool because when you do sessions in Nashville, these guys see everything. And they're just like, whatever, okay, what's the next thing? You know, all right, and they go in and knock it out. These guys, they listen to the work tape, and you see everybody kind of, the room change, and they're all like, what the hell is this? All right. And then they dug in and they really put some extra work into it. So
The energy was there.
So we got a bunch of that. I also am cutting a song called Till the Wheels Fall Off. And it's got, this is going to be crazy. It's got the bass player from Saving Abel and Tantric, the drummer from Luke Bryan. It's got the guitar player that used to be in Florida Georgia Line and Tantric. It's got the singer from Hinder, singer from Royal Bliss, myself, and my buddy named Michael Alexander up. And we're all doing it together as one. But we all recorded it in separate spots.
That's great.
And it's all four different vocalists. It's almost like we're calling it the Brotherhood.
Yeah. It sounds like it.
It's called The Brotherhood, and it's just all friends that have toured together and written together and stuff.
So does it sound as big as it feels?
It's a straight-up country song. I mean, it's a very... I wrote it with a guy named Arliss Albritton, and the original demo is actually Craig Wayne Boyd and I.
Okay.
Doing it as like a duo thing, which is really cool. And then I thought, well, let's just get more people. And then Michael and I have been talking about doing a thing called The Brotherhood, and this is like a perfect thing to do. So it's totally different. So we got that coming out. We have a song that's just taken off in Southeast Asia that we're actually re-releasing, which was weird. There's a phone over there called the Vivo phone, which is, I mean, Vivo underwrote the NBA tour. That's a major company in China and Indonesia. And they went ahead and loaded it onto one of their phones. The only song on their phone. Like, it's it. Like, if you get the Vivo phone, you have this side of you. And I've had people writing, all of a sudden, our video views and everything have gone through the roof. You know, even our streams have jumped up like 50, 60,000 in the last three or four weeks. So,
but look at that fan base.
Oh, yeah. We are building. It's great. And Indonesia is the fourth largest population in the world. Did you know that?
Did you?
I didn't know that.
Until now.
It's like India, China, America, and Indonesia. And then, yeah, so.
Well, you are the international man of mystery.
We have definitely, I've been around the world a couple times. Yes. I've definitely used up a couple passports.
So have you been to Southeast Asia?
No, I mean, I've been to Vietnam and I've been to China.
So maybe you need to go back over there.
So we need to go back over there. Definitely Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, all those places are really, and India are all really blowing up right now for us, which is kind of cool. Which I'm fine with that. So yeah, it's going to be an interesting year. Like I said, we're going out with brand new branding, the whole situation, a couple things already ready to go. And then, you know, obviously I'm going to keep writing and keep recording.
2020, so, it's all going to be different.
We're hoping, you know, just got to keep, you know, just keep your head down and just keep grinding. And
but do you love it?
Oh, of course. I mean, there's times when, you know, I would much rather be sitting on my couch doing nothing. But when you finally get there and you're on stage and you're having that moment, and you're playing that song and it sounds really good and you can tell you're connecting with people. I mean, that's why we do it. That's the main reason. Or when someone tells you a story about how a song affected them, that's important too. So
when they sing along,
yeah,
it makes it all
that's worthwhile. Always amazing, you know. And the cool thing about a lot of our songs is if they don't know it by the second chorus, they're already singing it. Yeah. So that's cool.
So when you're sitting on your couch, you know, where you really want to be, all you're thinking about are those moments too.
Well, that, or, you know, my wife and I are watching some, like, 90 Days, whatever those stupid shows are, you know?
Those reality shows.
Yeah. What is it, 90 Days, what are those shows called? Whatever. This is terrible. Those are horrible shows.
Those are horrible.
They're totally addictive, though.
But you get to watch them with your wife, and that makes it all better.
And our dog, so that's, dog. Yeah. But we're pretty lucky, too, because right now our schedule has been, we're really only working Thursday through Sunday. So I'm home Monday through Wednesday or Thursday, and then we're out.
We all want a little Rick Monroe. You got to spread the wealth.
Well, I need people to spread the word, too. And hey, anybody that is a fan of music, if you love a band, you know, it doesn't have to be us. It can be, I was like, sorry, I just hit that thing. I was, if you love music and you want to support a band, do it. Not just like a page, but actually go to a show, send their music around, stream their music, play their videos. Tell people about it. I know a lot of people are like, oh, I like your band. And a like isn't
it doesn't
really
do anything.
Making a difference. It helps. But be proactive, because without fans and without that, there will be no music. And then when you wonder where all your favorite artists went, well, you know, because we can't survive on nothing. So we just need people to be out there doing it.
Well, just remember when the radio first came out, it was word of mouth that made everyone else want one.
Right.
So we have to keep that passion up
for
music and what it does for our lives to make sure that we continue to tell everybody about it.
Yeah, because if you don't have music, who's, you know, what's going to be your soundtrack in life? I mean, come on.
No, you got nothing.
I couldn't imagine it.
We won't imagine it.
No, well, I'll still be making music. That's one good thing. Even if the apocalypse came, you still need storytellers. And I can play an acoustic guitar, so I think I'll be able to survive. I'll be that dude going from village to village going, let me tell the story.
He'll be playing us out.
Yeah.
I love it. Love it. Can't get enough of it. Look forward to seeing where you go in 2020.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Letting loose. Is that your hair down? Yeah, you're in the mood. Whoa, come on, wild. Something in the air, something different about that smile you wear, girl. Yeah, what is it when I think I know what's going on behind them brown eyes? Going through that little something, girl, takes me by surprise. Baby, I ain't ever seen this side of you before. I think I like. Seen it with my own eyes, I wouldn't believe it, girl. Can't believe that you were mine, a little red girl.
the right time. Your inhibitions, set them all aside. I could get used to you taking my breath away. As long as you got more than secrets coming my way. Yeah, baby, I ain't ever seen this side of you before. I think I like it. I'd like to see you a whole lot more. Dangling your toes over the edge. All out of control. Baby, I ain't ever seen this side of you before. Well, I think I know what's going on behind them brown eyes. Going through that little something, girl, takes me by.
That was Rick Monroe with This Side of You. Where there's smoke, there's fire. And if you want more of Rick, who wouldn't? Follow him on social media at Rick Monroe Official. And be sure to follow us as well at Marquee Backstage. Tune in next week to Marquee Backstage All Access for C4, a Kentucky rock trio whose career is about to explode. Before we go, we're going to send you off with one more high-energy song from Rick Monroe. This is Cocaine Cold and Whiskey Shakes. Until next time, I'm your host, Julie Milam. We'll see you next week on Marquee Backstage All Access.
Cocaine cold and whiskey shakes. Trying to drown my heartache. I don't know how much I can take. 'Cause I got cocaine cold and whiskey shakes. Coming down but far from sober, yeah. Mirror is clouded with white lines. Trying to hide from this hangover that whiskey bottle has done run dry. This crazy way I'm living, yeah. Too much for her to snag. Past the point of forgiving, right into the arms of another man. Cocaine cold and whiskey shakes. Trying to drown my heartache. I don't know how much I can take. I got cocaine cold and whiskey shakes. How did I get so addicted, to my ego, pride, and lies? I let that woman walk away. Didn't beg her to stay. I didn't even say goodbye. Why? Cocaine cold and whiskey shakes. Trying to drown my heartache. I got cocaine cold and whiskey shakes, yeah.
cocaine cold and whiskey shakes, trying to drown my heartache. I don't know how much I can take. I got cocaine cold and whiskey shakes. Don't know how much I can take. Na 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 na, get a little na 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 na.